Well, even though we've just enjoyed some beautiful worship music, I'd like to share one more song with you. And I have a small reward for anyone who can guess the name of this tune. Start to recognize it like Jerry.
Please allow me to introduce myself. I'm a man of wealth and taste. I've been around for a long, long year. Stole many a man's soul of faith. I was around when Jesus Christ had his moment of doubt and pain. Made damn sure the pilot washed his hands and sealed his face. Pleased to meet you. Hope you guess my name.
So, Jerry guessed it right away because, well, what can I say? He's still young.
What's the prize?
What's the prize? Actually,
you get a tuna salad sandwich on a fresh bun?
That's right. He gets to eat all the tuna salad sandwiches on fresh buns. We're gonna share lunch. No, I had a stimulating discussion on Wednesday with our seniors group on the subject of evil and if the devil really exists. And there are those who think that the concept of a person, a being who is the personification of evil and the author of evil is really a condescension to help us to understand the subject. On the other hand, all of us around the table, we're kind of convinced that there is a person who is the devil, Satan, that serpent. And the help of the Rolling Stones, I introduce you to him today, just as I believe that Jesus met him face to face during a time of trial and testing. This is why I entitle a sermon, When Jesus Faced Satan. I have real trouble thinking that Jesus cast out demons, but as we might say today, if somebody was deeply troubled, that they have mental issues. Now, maybe they do have mental issues. Mental health is a serious consideration, whether we like to admit it or not. Schizophrenia, depression, many, many other mental disorders that we don't look and immediately ascribe to a demon. We should not immediately ascribe to a demon. In fact, we should probably eventually never ascribe it to a demon. But in Jesus' case, demons came to him, and the voices that came out of the individuals declared, "Have you come to torment us before our time?" And when Jesus faced evil in his time and place and context, he named it the work of the prince of darkness, the prince of this world, Satan. And he also referred to the fact that in his ministry, he saw Satan being defeated. And that defeat began, we are told, in a confrontation that took place this time of year. It's celebrated by the Christian church in this story of Lent, which is a loose referral to the time leading up to the resurrection on Easter Sunday. Chapter 4, we read, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the desert. Now, in the accounts that we find in the Synoptic Gospels, a lot of details are left out. If we were to go to the book of John, we would find out that after he is baptized at the Jordan, Jesus spends a few days and literally calls from John's disciples his group of disciples, individuals he wants to come with him. And then he spends a little while getting to know them and allowing them to get to know him, and then he disappears for a while, and then he goes obviously into the wilderness. But if I could term it this way, the point of the Gospels the Synoptic Gospels is to say simply that Jesus' number one priority before he goes to the community, before he goes to the world, is to first of all go to the wilderness. And in going to the wilderness, it's as if he is saying, before I begin to preach to others and minister to others, I am going to preach, if you will, to myself. I, as a human being, as a man, I'm going to face what I'm going to tell everybody else to face, the fact that there is a devil. And by the way, when the Rolling Stones wrote that song, Sympathy for the Devil, they weren't saying you should have sympathy for the devil. What they were saying is, look at the litany of evil in the 20th century. You might want to be aware of this person. You might want to be aware of evil, because as they write in their lyrics, you better take attention to me, because if you do not, I will have your soul to waste. Oh, that's an interesting idea, especially coming from a couple of rock and rollers. You might even look and say, yeah, that's kind of happened in your case, guys. But as they contemplated evil, and the one who wrote that song was Keith Richards, if you look at Keith, he's obviously been through the bush backwards and faced a few trials and tribulations in his life. But I think he called it exactly right. You need to understand that there is a person devoting himself to thwarting goodness and thwarting the will of God. And Jesus confronts him first. It tells us for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. Now, when it says 40 days, that term, I believe, is literal, but there's why 40 is the number. 40 is the number of trial and testing. 40 is the number where Moses had to lead the children of Israel through the wilderness, and during which they were tried and tested. And so all of this is showing us, and especially the Jewish community, that this Son of God, unlike the nation which God called his son, which he drew out of Egypt, this Son of God, who was drawn out of Egypt, is going to be successful because he's going to face up to the first challenge. And it tells us that he is tempted by the devil. And I believe it's sort of during the 40 days. It's not after 40 days that he finally faces Satan. I think during the 40 days, he faces all along the realities of what it is to be human and what it is to be tried and tested by evil. It's during these days, and at the end of them, he was hungry. Well, at that moment, you might say, Luke, you know, you're playing Captain Obvious here. Clearly, he's going to be hungry after 40 years. But fasting is associated with the desire to seek God, to find time to draw close to God, to deny the physical and to embrace the spiritual. That's the essential picture that you're getting from fasting. And as Jesus, through the ongoing temptation, is confronting the realities of evil and hearing the temptations and the trials, we see in this everything that we also have to face. Let me explain. The devil said to him, if you're the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. Now, Jesus obviously has power over natural elements, doesn't he? Jesus had recently turned water into wine for the simple purpose of teaching his disciples a lesson and to impress upon them that he was able to do miracles, and oh, by the way, as a favor to his relatives at a family wedding. So he has a legitimate need, and also he can give into this need, if you will. He can satisfy this need, but there's a bit of a problem. He is facing the challenge of, will he become, if you will, hedonistic, or will he pursue the spiritual? Now, when I say hedonistic, you might say, well, that implies giving oneself over to pleasure. And it's not an evil thing. We do have needs that need to be satisfied. And in this particular case, though, physical needs cannot be allowed to rule us. By that I mean the idea of hedonism is that we should seek as the ultimate goal in life happiness, satisfaction, pleasure. It doesn't imply that you have to be given over to debauchery and horribly excessive ways of life. But to minimize pain and maximize satisfaction is kind of the natural, normal way that human beings operate. And so when the devil says to him, look, if you are the Son of God, meaning you stand before me in flesh and in blood, you stand before me and I'm going to call into understanding of yourself, your own sense of identity, well, do something. Now, again, we are all driven by basic needs. I got up first thing this morning and I went directly to the bathroom. Now, none of you should snicker because I'm pretty sure a lot of you did the same thing because a lot of you were aging as well. You get up in the morning, where do you have to go? There's a natural, normal need. Then the next place you go is to where? The fridge. Well, the coffee pot, yeah. You have to go to the fridge to get the cream. You have to go to the fridge to get some water to revive the flesh that has been exhaling vapor all night long. So you wake up with a dry mouth and all sorts of other things that are physiological processes. So we are built, if you will, from the ground up with a whole bunch of realities, all right? Those realities were summarized in a particular way by Maslow. I'm sure you all remember from your introduction to psychology or somewhere or other, Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Okay, it's on the final exam, so pay attention. Maslow put it this way. He said, look, first of all, we all start out with a reality. We all have physiological needs. As I said, you have to go to the bathroom. You have to go to the fridge and get some cool water or some cream for the coffee. But it kind of, you know, these things are normal in the morning. You have physiological needs. You need food. Need certain things to keep you going. The first and most obvious physiological need is what?
Egg salad.
Egg salad. you're going to leave that one alone, are you? The first and obvious physiological need is air. I got to breathe. We come face to face with Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Immediately somebody clamps a hand over our mouth. And it takes a few hours, but the rest of these things kick in. You know, if you don't have food, chances are you could be forced to deny all of your other needs, and you would go ahead and try to steal. That's just the way it is. We need bread to sustain us. We need food. After physiological needs, we need safety. And so, but we'll ignore safety if we need food. And if we are fed and we are sheltered and reasonably secure, we are going to reach for relationship. We are going to reach for other needs to be fulfilled, belonging. After that, we might wish to belong and also have respect, a lot like Rodney Dangerfield. Hey, I'm not getting any respect. Well, you wouldn't be worrying about respect, Rodney, if you weren't getting air or water or food. You wouldn't worry about that if you were feeling unsafe. You know, nobody during wartime says, I don't feel as though you're respecting my feelings, because they're sheltered from imminent danger. When these things are taken care of, finally we find what time is left over for higher ideals. We call it self-actualization. Now, Jesus, in a way, turns this upside down, because he says to the adversary who says, look, you know, you're hungry, you have the power, turn the stones into bread. And Jesus counters with a simple statement from the law. It is written, man does not live on bread alone. Now, that's not all there is to it, but he pushes back and answers the argument. And this is a challenge. Jesus asks us in his Sermon on the Mount to turn the priorities in our life upside down. What do we seek first? We seek bread. We seek food. We seek, you know, if we have bread, then we want something to go on top of it, you know, and we build from there. And Jesus says, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things does all of humanity seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all of these things. So he's not saying, hey, just, you know, deny yourself, but he's saying, get a priority here. Seek first a relationship with your Father in heaven. Seek first his dominion, his kingdom, and his way of doing things, his rightness. Do things appropriately in accordance with your Creator, and the other things will fall into line where they belong and as they belong. Take therefore no, and the original Greek really says, anxious thought for tomorrow. Because let's face it, we all take anxious thought. I go to Costco and I get gas because it's kind of a little cheaper there. And then I want to go into Costco and I just don't go in and say, give me one of those $1.50 all beef Polish sausages, although they are enjoyable, and they come in a white bun, something I can't get at home except on a rare occasion. Then I go in there and I say, let us buy enough to get through the entire week. Not because I'm kind of anxious, but because I do think about tomorrow and the next day and the next day. And that can become an anxiety matter. If you're kind of worried about money or you're worried about some of these necessities, he says, look, tomorrow will have enough stress and strain of itself. Sufficient unto the day are the necessary things. That's what he's saying. Sufficient unto today is the stress and strain and the evil thereof. Don't tally any anxious thought for tomorrow. If you've got the first thought for today being your relationship with your Father in heaven. Now, what we're seeing unfolding here then are the way in which Jesus is addressing human needs. Things that are in the world. If any man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in it. If that's your preoccupation, if that's the only thing way that you're programmed, then you got a problem. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, what was the first thing Satan referred to? Your flesh has a desire. In fact, it's a legitimate desire. In fact, you have the power to fulfill this desire, but I'm going to play on that. I'm going to work on that. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. Now, is it wrong to meet the needs of the flesh? Well, no, but are you going to be dominated by them? All these three things that I've just listed, John says, is not of the Father, but is of the world. Now, the world's going to pass away. And the lust thereof. But he that does the will of God abides forever. Now what an idea. I'm reversing this. I'm turning the priorities upside down. I'm asking you to just recognize these things, but not be dominated by them. And so let's take a look again at Maslow's hierarchy of needs. These are observation. You start out with breathing, food, water, the fact that we're sexually driven, sleep. Homeostasis, excretion. In other words, all of these bodily functions, all of these things that immediately observed are natural and normal. After that, we said security or safety. But he observed that in this term, the security of the body. Then you need security of employment, resources. A stable environment, morality, the family, health, property, all of these things. These tend to dominate us next. And after that, of course, then we have time for relationship, friendship, family, and sexual intimacy, which is a very different thing from sexual desire. Then afterwards, self-esteem, confidence, achievement, respect of others, respect by others. And finally, as he observed, when we finally reach the point of taking care of our needs. Well, then we got time and energy for morality, creativity, spontaneity, problem solving instead of fighting. We can put aside our prejudices and our anger, and we can actually focus on facts because we're secure enough to be able to say, okay, this is an objective, realistic view of things. Before that, we're driven by what? The need for security, the need for comfort, the need for a desire to have our experience respected, our family values, all of these things. You gotta have all these other things humanly speaking care of before you reach the point of saying, okay, I don't have to be driven by these things. I got enough energy left over to be moral, to be spiritual. On the other hand, Jesus said, you start out with the idea that I am seeking to be spiritual, I am seeking to be moral, I'm seeking God's righteousness in his kingdom, and the other things then can then fall into place. And with the reassurance, look, I know your Father in heaven knows you need all these things. But as a man, he faces the ultimate test. And the first test is, okay, you need food. Yes, I do. So you've got power. I know you got power. You know, you turn water into wine, turn rocks into bread. You know, there's a bit of a parallel there, isn't there? Because Moses led the children of Israel for 40 years through the wilderness, and by miracle, bread was provided. And so a lot of parallels that are going here. But the first test is basic need. The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, I'll give you all their authority and splendor, for it has been given to me. Nobody challenges me. I am the prince of this world. Jesus acknowledges that later. He says, but he has been defeated, but he is the prince of this world, and he's angry. There's words of his at the Last Supper. And he said, the original prophecy in Genesis, he's going to bite at the heel, but the foot is going to come down and crush his head. Well, right now, he said, I will give you all their authority and splendor, for it has been given to me, and I give it to you. If you worship me, it's all yours. You do not have to take the hard path. You do not have to take the difficult choices. So what does he appeal to? Well, he's gone, first of all, to the basic human needs. Now he is appealing to what John termed his second, if you will, tier of the world, the lust of the eyes, or what we might say is. And so Jesus is tested, he's pushed in this area, just as you and I are, just as you and I. And how does he respond to that? Well, Jesus answered, it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Now, you've offered me a shortcut to succeed my purpose, which is to redeem the world, to become, if you will, the Lord of heaven and earth. But I'm not going to take that shortcut. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to do things in the way that my Father in heaven has said. I'm going to be offering a lot of people this advice. Seek first the kingdom of God and the rightness of God, the righteousness of God. Walk in his steps, follow his path, accept his direction and authority, and I'm going to do this myself first. I'm going to lead the way. I'm going to set an example. Worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Oh, okay. That's what's playing out here. The devil led him to Jerusalem. Now, obviously, this is in the spirit, but he takes him, if you will, and it stands him on the highest point of the temple. And I think it's on the southeast corner. There used to be a huge turret that went up, and he literally has him standing on this turret. And he says here, if you're the Son of God, if you're the Son of God, Doesn't the psalm say, throw yourself down? The psalm says he will command his angels and you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Oh, now, not only checking you out here and seeing if you can still keep your identity as the Son of God, but I am actually quoting the promises from the Messianic Psalms. Now, at this particular point, then the words of John come back to us. The pride of life, the pride that we have in life. We want respect. We want to be understood to be important. That's up there on the hierarchy of needs. We sometimes call that egotism. We all have an ego. We want to be understood, accepted, agreed with. And this is what's challenged. But how does Jesus respond to that? He says simply this. It says, don't push your luck with God. Or, do not put the Lord your God to the test. Don't think you're going to try him, demand he answer in a particular way, if he is God. Now, that's not the entire subject, obviously, but Jesus takes a statement out of Deuteronomy and he puts it back to Satan and he backs him off. And this, in summation, is the story of what Jesus is facing in the wilderness. And it, I believe, is an ongoing challenge for the 40 days. It's not just at the end of 40 days he has an afternoon chat with Satan. But it tells us when the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. It doesn't say that, he left him, I'm totally defeated. He said, I'll be back. I will return when you are at another low point, when you show your weakness again. And right now, observing you as a fragile human being, I observe you to be weak. You're fasting. I can see you going down day by day by day. And so I should be able to overcome you. But here is the reality in this particular statement. He left him until an opportune time. Why is that important? It's important to me because it tells me one thing: temptation never goes away. And that's why Satan can return in the garden to tempt him, to stress him. And so likewise, just as Jesus has faced the flesh, has faced the need for materialism, has faced the need for ego, so do we. We go through exactly the same trials. And they are not faced, you know, one, two, three. They are faced in circumstances that vary. And if you will, he is able to play a tune on those three areas anytime that he sees our vulnerability, anytime he sees an opportune time. Temptation represents itself, presents itself many times and many challenges. Nice quotable quote I ran across. It says, most who face temptation usually leave a forwarding address. Think about that for a minute. Yes, we leave temptation behind and we move on, but it's sort of, we're still known where we are. Why? Because we're still in the flesh, struggling, and continually, if you will, faced with that challenge. I'm reminded of the old story of the gal who comes home and says to her husband, look at this. And he observes her in a brand new dress. And he said, how much did that cost? And he suspects it's very expensive. And she gives him the price. He says, oh, we can't afford that. And she said, it just spoke to me. And he said, the devil was tempting you. Did you say to the devil that you wouldn't? Honey, you got to understand, the devil made me do it. Well, what did you say to the devil? You were supposed to say to him, get thee behind me, Satan. Well, I told him, get me behind me, Satan. You know what? He told me it looked good from the back, too. Constantly, we find ourselves stressed and strained in these areas. The flesh, if you will. The intellect. The emotions. These three areas that we are constantly, and as John calls them, the world, just the reality of the space that we live in. the lust of the eyes, the pride of the heart, things like that. So Jesus has shown us that he has faced these very things. Another quotable quote, knocks once. Temptation leans on the doorbell. Temptation leans on the doorbell. We are driven by these things. And Jesus, when he went before us, before he turned and instructed us in the Sermon on the Mount, said, look, this I understand because I've gone through it myself. I have faced it myself. I started off by facing it. I looked in the mirror, if you will, and I faced myself, flesh and blood. I went out into the wilderness and I faced the source of evil. And this is what I have done for myself. This is what I have done on your behalf. I have succeeded. Now you have to understand the way that you are. Plato observed that we are fiery steeds. We are headstrong horses, if you will, ruled, he says, by appetites, desires, lusts, motivations. We need to be ruled, he said, by wisdom, self-control, and intelligence. And if we were to go to the fruits of the Holy Spirit, what would they be? Well, self-control, wisdom, the mind of God, which we have been shown. We need to understand why Jesus did what he did, and also recognize the reality that there is a source of evil. As I said, we began our discussion with, is there really a devil? And I can't get away from the fact that whether it's in the Gospels, whether it's in the discussion of the Old Testament, or whether it's in the words of Paul or the other apostles, it's true there, that we need to understand imagery, we need to understand analogies and figures of speech, but throughout it, the scriptures from Genesis to Revelation, there runs this reality that there is really one person who's termed the adversary, the accuser. You know, in popular myth, we talk about the voice of God as one angel on our shoulder, and the voice of the devil is another evil spirit on our shoulder. And we try to understand those realities, but I also think there's a very beautiful concept which has been put forward, which is simply that the greatest trick the devil has ever pulled is to suggest to us that he doesn't exist. And this is not a condescension to say, look, we got to understand evil some way or other, so let's embodiment in a person. No, there really is an evil spirit. And when he is called the accuser of the brethren, that was when he could invoke the law, the requirements of which had not been satisfied by Jesus at the cross. He was the prosecutor. In fact, the original term Satan in the Old Testament means, if you will, the prosecuting attorney, the one who can invoke the law and point out where you have failed. And so he is either the prosecutor or the accuser, he is called in the New Testament. And he really is there. He's also the tempter, which is why Jesus, again, goes out and faces him. He's a real personality. He's a real personal. He's a real creation. And he works and he trolls to see, well, at an opportune time, how vulnerable we are to those temptations. James offers us then this particular formula for, if you will, survival. Submit yourselves then to God. Very familiar, since if you were asked to seek first the kingdom of God, well, then you're going to submit yourself to God. And then this bit of good news, resist the devil, and he's going to leave you alone. Why? Well, he's really smart and he doesn't need to waste his time. And so resistance and frustrates him, backs him off. Okay, you made a choice. I'm not going to waste my time today. But don't worry, I'll be back. I will be back. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Now, that's an expression of speech. Sometimes we use the expression, when you feel distant from God, ask yourself, who moved? Because God's presence and love and support is constant. On the other hand, it can feel, from our point of view, as though he's drawing closer to us. We will feel the presence of God more. So you seek him, as the other expression goes, if you seek him with all your heart, you shall truly find him, as Isaiah says. And then another expression, wash your hands, sinners. What did Pilate do when he wanted to just absolve himself of any involvement in this travesty of injustice? He publicly washed his hands. I'm not part of this. So do not be party to sin, you sinners. And not only that, look at your motivations. Look where these things come from. Well, where do they come from? Well, it's true, I have needs and they may be legitimate, but they've got to be realigned with the desires of God, the rightness of God. I see, I desire, but it's got to be realigned with what God is intending for us. Yeah, we like to be respected, but the greatest source of respect is the affection we have already been shown by God our Father. So it says, purify your hearts, you who are double-minded. And let's face it, we're all double-minded. We're torn. We're torn back and forth between these legitimate but driving and overpowering desires. And yet the example is given us of Jesus, who first of all understands himself, faces them, and recognizes that they make him vulnerable to the prey of somebody who's against him, the one who's called the adversary. Now, you and I are called upon by Jesus to seek strength from our Father in heaven, to appeal to him, to remind ourselves in prayer. This is a constant challenge. As the old saying goes, Lord, things are going so well today. I thank you that you have awakened me, that I greet this brand new day. But Lord, I remind you, in just a moment, I'm going to open my eyes and climb out of this bed, and I have a feeling things are going to go wrong from there on. But first of all, this is a brand new day. Give me the strength to tackle it. Give me the realistic understanding that there is an evil presence, and that evil presence would like to seduce me into placing what are start off as legitimate needs in my life, but allowing them to become illegitimate and allowing them to dominate. As I said, I think it's valuable to look at what Maslow said. This is the way human beings are built. But then go back and ask, well, what did Jesus say? Well, you kind of got the priorities. This is the way you may operate naturally and normally, this hierarchy of needs. If you understand that, you can manipulate the customer. If you understand that, you can manage the workforce. If you understand that, you can relate to your neighbor and get a better deal. If you understand that, you can negotiate. But if you're driven by that, you know what? You're going to remain very flawed and very human, and you are going to do exactly what you were not created to do. You're just going to live by the flesh and be driven by the world. When you were created to be joined in spirit and be recreated in a different image, in the image of the one who faced the adversary and said, yeah, I know this is flesh and blood, but you're not going to dictate the way it will operate. At the end of the prayer that our Lord taught, it says simply this, and I quote this from the New Revised Standard Version, do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one. We would probably say, lead us not into temptation, but forgive us and deliver us from evil. And there is a controversy as to how that should be rendered. There are some who say because it's in the masculine gender in the Greek or something like that it should be understood the evil one. Others will argue it doesn't matter, evil, evil one, it all amounts to the same thing, that we are subject to the stresses of evil, which is to say we are subject to the stresses of, John's words, a world. The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life. But the good news is Jesus faced and overcame these things. And he has offered us the strength to do the same thing, to back those things off, those unbelievable desires we have, to reinforce our ego, to justify who we are and what we're doing. It's very hard to bite your tongue and not say something snarky when you know that it is inappropriate or evil. We're all driven by some of those things. If I may give a more humorous example, which does not imply that this is necessarily evil, but we were having a heated conversation the other day, my dear little wife and me, and we were back and forth and back and forth. And on one particular point, she got quite stirred up, and I said in my condescending way, I said, "My dear, there's no need to be rattled by that. There's no need to go into orbit. I think you went there within 3 seconds. She looked at me and she said, "Why waste time?" And that is the way we are naturally normally built. And by the time it takes me 8 or 9 seconds to go into orbit. But this is, these are the sort of things that stress and strain us. Okay. Don't you laugh. I know how long it takes you. But anyway, this is built. And Jesus, in his example, is not some distant, spiritually detached sort of allegory or story. This is him saying, this is where we all live, people. This is why I came to live among you, to set you an example. This is us. This is humanity facing the stresses and strains of an adversary who understands exactly how to lay our soul to waste. Are you going to learn from that? Are you going to take instruction from that? Well, I hope we did just a little today. I hope you saw yourself in the wilderness. I hope you saw yourself being driven by all the things that naturally and normally drove Jesus. But I hope you can also remember that in Christ you have been given the opportunity and the strength to not only recognize it, but stand there and say, "Hey, I don't have to go there. I don't have to go in orbit. I don't have to go to the lowest denominator. I don't have to capitulate to this. I can really do what Jesus has asked me to do, which is seek first the kingdom of my Father in heaven and his rightness. And in so doing, I can not only embrace life in a different way today, but as John put it so simply, you will live forevermore." I hope you recognize the devil and where he's come from. And I hope that in Jesus and his experience, you got a pretty good introduction. Let's pray. Our Father, as we come back to rehearse the meaning of this time of year and the trial that our Savior went through, we ask that we can not just think of it as something nice that he did for us, although it's something incredibly beautiful that he has done for us, but not just something he's done for us and it's distant and it's accomplished and done. Beyond that reality, it's something he did which illustrates and teaches us that we too can go through the same wilderness of this world and be equally as successful as long as you, through the Holy Spirit, are with us and in us. Give us the strength, the insight, the understanding to resist the devil, knowing that he has to flee from us, and to pray daily, as you taught us, that we be delivered from evil, because yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.